TLC, we welcome you all to yet another session. Amongst us today we have two speakers who have their knowledge which is well known amongst all of us, those who follow law or those who don't follow law, in the sense not law what a common citizen does. For not following law means who is not a lawyer as such. So once the topic today itself is criminal justice and the rule of law in India, we thought that the best way to put across the things would be to have the speakers who are immense amongst known for their knowledge. We have Honorable Mr. Justice Justice Mleshwar, who has been the former judge of the Supreme Court of India. He had also been the Chief Justice of Guwahati High Court and Kerala High Court. His judgments, his conduct inside the court and outside the court is well known. His popularity, though there are a large number of participants, amongst them is one of them is Mr. Aseem Pandya, who is the former president of Gujarat Bar Association and is a designated senior. He has also come on a platform once. His views for the NJAC verdict is well known, then on Shreya Singhal and so on and on. And those who have been following cricket and politics, the judgment of Navjot Sidhu, popularly known as Navjot Sidhu's judgment, otherwise it's the other way around. And then we have Mr. Dr. Argo Sen Gupta. When I invited Dr. Argo Sen Gupta, I said that if it had not been known otherwise, commonly we would have thought it's Argya Sen Gupta, or we can say Agrega Sen Gupta, that we have to make a request to him that you should come on the board. That's the way we normally pronounce. He is a research director of Vidhi Center for Legal Policies, is known for, is an expert in this field. He has served number of government committees, including most recently Justice B.N. Shri Krishna committee led on data protection. And data protection becomes a very relevant topic in the today's scenario. And his insights on various issues, there's a large following. As we say, there's a fan following. Once you are known within the legal circles and beyond the legal circles, then the following as to what are his stakes, etc., is always considered in the right perspective. What is his stake? Each word is as good as pounds of gold. Today we will be having the format slightly different, since we have amongst us Justice Chalmeshwar and Arg Sen Gupta. Instead of having a monologue dialogue, we have been having the interactive sessions. Today, the format would be slightly different. It will be a more of an interactive session. We get the insights of two persons known within their field and outside the field for their knowledge. Argo Sen Gupta would be taking certain questions with Justice Chalmeshwar, who will be giving insights. But at the same time, the chat box would be open. Everybody should restrain posting the chats relevant with the topic. We will also be going live with the Facebook, and the questions posted on the Facebook, I can take it or Mr. Argo can take it, and we will have the insights of both the persons. Sir, welcome again. Formally to state therein that we are setting it into motion, with Argo taking the calls with the certain questions in his own style. Argo carries his own style of asking. Over to you, Argo, and the way we take, let's see how the new format goes into it. Thank you, both of you.
Thank you very much, Vikas. Thank you for that introduction. And thank you, Justice Chalmeshwar, for having this conversation today. You haven't been one of the former Supreme Court judges who has been very popular on Zoom, as in there are some judges who have been doing many webinars. But I think, if I'm not mistaken, this is the first one. And I'm delighted that to do this with Punjab University and Beyond Law CLC. So thank you very much, Vikas, for having invited us. So the format, as Vikas said, we'll do a conversation for about 30 to 40 minutes, and then we'll be happy to take questions, which you can put on the chat box. Vikas, if there's anything on Facebook or YouTube, then you can let me know so that we can take those questions as well. So Justice Chalmeshwar, let me start with an article that I had written just after the Hyderabad encountered killings. And with your permission, I'll just quote a little paragraph of what I had said there. The encounter killings of Shiva, Arif, Naveen and Chenna Keshavalu in Hyderabad has united India in one respect. No one genuinely believes that it was an accidental encounter. The statements by the Hyderabad police, that is, it was a crime reconstruction in the dead of the night, the attempt by the accused to snatch weapons, fatally accurate shots being fired by the police ostensibly in self-defense, are so far-fetched that every right-thinking person believes that the encounter was staged to deliver instant justice to the suspected rapist murderers. What was, however, conspicuous was the wide-ranging support for the actions of the Hyderabad police. Rishi Kapoor had congratulated them, Saina Nehwal had saluted them, and Jaya Bachchan had said that, as a member of parliament, that she demanded an even more extreme measure than in instant justice, that is public lynching. And I'm sure various uncles, aunts and friends on WhatsApp groups had asserted that justice indeed had been done. Given the fact that we are discussing this primarily with a group of lawyers, why do you think the criminal justice apparatus in the public mind seems to have collapsed?
Well, with utmost respect for all those who pleaded for instant justice, who found a justification for the incident, I do understand their agony and their outbursts of justification of instant justice formula. But the point is, yeah, why is it happening? That is a more important question. But Arghya, exactly 2 days before the event, the killing took place, the encounter took place, I was in a meeting in Hyderabad. A couple of politicians were there, both belonging to the Communist Party. And a retired director general of police was there, former state of Andhra Pradesh gentleman, and eminent writer, lady writer in Telugu. So I spoke on this topic, because by then these calls were coming, the demands were coming that please execute them summarily or hand over them. The crowds gathered in front of the police station, demanding that the accused be handed over to them so that they can deal with them. So on, this kind of things are appearing in newspapers. So in this background, in fact, I don't know whether you remember it or not, almost a decade back, in a town called Warangal in the present state of Telangana, a similar incident took place. Some boys.
Sorry to bother you. So slightly, yeah, you will have to come closer to the mic because people are saying that the audibility is slightly poor.
Do I remove this microphone and speak directly?
That would be fantastic. I am also without microphone.
Okay. How is it now?
I can just. How is it? Kindly post it on the chat box.
So just say a little bit more, then we'll be able to answer.
Yes, that's true.
How is it?
Yeah, I think it's better. Just say a little bit more, sir. Just give us a sentence, then we'll understand.
Okay.
So can you hear us?
I can hear you, please.
Yeah, so if you speak at this volume, it'll be fine, sir. Just speak up a little bit.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Now?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Okay. See, about a decade back, exactly here I remember, 2009 or 2010, there was a similar incident. Some boys threw acid on the face of a young girl with juvenile problems. And then eventually it resulted in the killing of those two boys by the police. The same version that they were trying to escape the custody, you know, they tried to attack the police. So whatever, I am not going into the truth or otherwise of the other. It's irrelevant for our discussion. The point is, the public reaction thereafter was almost similar. People started congratulating the police for what had happened, and so on and so forth. There were huge processions taken in Warangal town by the students union. The parents
slightly more louder. Still, people are saying the issues continues to persist.
More louder, is it?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So,
Albert, you can also just listen to that.
Yes, sorry. Sir.
I was saying,
Argo
can also take regarding the audibility. Yes, sir.
Yeah. See, the reactions from the public and civil society were similar. There were huge processions organized congratulating the police for what they had done. And similar reactions were seen those days. In fact, I remember when one of those TV channels was conducting some kind of a survey on this incident, an advocate in robes made a statement saying, what is wrong with it? I know what happens. If the matter is to be sent for trial, the words are to be sent for trial, the whole process will take 25 years before any final verdict is given. So what is wrong with it is done. This is the understanding of even a member of the PAR. All this is part of the required, all telecasts all over the country. So therefore, what is the problem? The problem is, the last, apart from what happened during British India, we had reason to blame a foreign ruler for everything that went wrong in the country. We had an excuse to say the foreign ruler. But then for the last 70 years, there was no foreign ruler. What have we done with the system? What have we done with the administration of criminal law? It's something which is not very pleasant to examine. Now, it's a fact that the culmination of any criminal proceeding, starting from the investigation, from the registration of the crime to the final conclusion, that is the trial, an appeal perhaps to the High Court, depending upon the nature of the crime, and then an SLP to the Supreme Court and an appeal. Well, it, in some cases, at least thereafter, if the Supreme Court gives a death penalty, the mercy petition before it is all legally sanctioned process. Now, it is no doubt a very, in theory, a very civilized process that we have on the record. But question is, how efficient the process is the question. Yeah. I'll just give you two cases which I had occasion to deal with to demonstrate what's going on. See, one of the cases is a case which I dealt in Andhra Pradesh, erstwhile Andhra Pradesh High Court, now divided into two separate High Courts, Andhra Pradesh and Telangana, in 2006. It was a facially a hilarious case, but legally a very distressing one. A particular gentleman called Rajaya belonged to one of those banned outfits, one of those ML outfits. Now, at that point of time, sometime in 2006, the superintendent of police of Karimnagar district constituted a special party to apprehend this man, who, according to information available at that point of time, was somewhere around Barabanki in Uttar Pradesh. So a party was dispatched from Karimnagar. These people went, and on a particular day, if I remember right, it is on the 31st of August 2006, the police party which proceeded from Karimnagar located this man in the bus stand of Barabanki town. I don't know, Barabanki is a town or a village, I think it's a town. They located him. Immediately, these seven or eight police personnel deputed from Karimnagar pounced on the man to apprehend him. All these people who are in plain clothes. Then this man was accompanied by some four others. Allegedly, his followers, most probably, yes. That because these people were in plain clothes, they thought it's some local, the gundas trying to molest them. Those four people resisted. Then it ensued in a scuffle. Then the local UP police came and picked up all these people, these four, five people, there's Rajaya and his associates, and also the Prem Nagar police people who were in plain clothes. All of them were taken to the Barabanki police station. Then after certain inquiries, it was found out that these people belong to the police force of the erstwhile state of Andhra Pradesh. Afterwards, these people were allowed to take Rajaya and his associates with them. All the five people were dumped into cars, and these people started proceeding to Andhra Pradesh, the old Andhra Pradesh state. After the team entered Andhra Pradesh territory, then obviously it must have dawned on the police party that against four of them, they had no authority to arrest. Basically, they were deputed to apprehend Rajaya. Against the other four people, there was no authorization to arrest them. There was no crime. It's a matter of record of the High Court. Admittedly, there was no crime registered against other four people in Andhra Pradesh. When I say Andhra Pradesh exists from that day. Now, there was no crime registered. So therefore, then obviously some doubts arose. And then what they did was, they produced all the five, the police people produced all the five of these apprehended. Rajaya and his associate before the local, one of the local police stations, with an allegation that these people wanted to answer the calls of the major. When the vehicles were stopped, unable them to answer the calls of the major, they tried to escape by snatching the weapons. You know, one of those stories heard too frequently in this country. And therefore, they committed an offense. And all these people were, after crime was registered, afterwards, they were produced before the local magistrate, concerned magistrate of the police station. And the remand was ordered. Challenging the remand, habeas corpus petition was filed with the High Court. Eventually, it was heard by me, during the inquisitor by me. Now, these are the basic facts. Now, we had, after hearing the matter, had to allow the repetition insofar as four of Rajaya's associates are concerned. For various reasons recorded in the judgment, the reported judgment, I gave it to Rajaya.
So, if I could come in there, I have shared the judgment with everybody, so they would have. So, I actually had two questions about the judgment. As in, so, first is in relation, so everybody has the basic facts, and for those for whom the sound is a little unclear, as in basically you've got the gist of it, that there were persons who were from Andhra Pradesh who had gone to Barabanki. They were arrested by the Andhra Pradesh police in
Barabanki. Not all. Two of them are from Maharashtra, actually.
Two of them were from Maharashtra and they were brought back to Andhra Pradesh. And now the questions arose regarding the legality of the arrest of the main gentleman, Rajaya, and his four accomplices. Now, And so, the question, so Justice Chelameshwar, I read the judgment and I found that you had two different, there were two different sets of holdings. First, in relation to Rajaya, the judgment holds that as far as Rajaya is concerned, technically the arrest that was made in Uttar Pradesh by the Andhra Pradesh police was not technically legal because the warrant had not been endorsed. Okay, I'm not getting into more details for the audience. As far as the remaining four people are concerned, you had held that the Andhra Pradesh police had no jurisdiction whatsoever to arrest
them in Andhra Pradesh.
Exactly.
Barabanki, assuming it to be an offense,
it's an offense that is in Barabanki, and the Andhra Pradesh police has no jurisdiction.
And their apprehension itself, I wouldn't even call it an arrest because arrest is a legal term. They were physically brought here by force.
That's right. So in some sense, it is a kidnapping of some persons. But anyway, be that as it may. So my question was on Rajaya. Now, in terms of Rajaya, as in, I think the holding is very interesting for our listeners because it gives an insight into the mind of a judge in a criminal law matter. You find that the arrest, and I thank my research assistant Vasudha Verma for this. She has done quite a bit of research on this. So thank you. She's also on this call. You find that as far as Rajaya is concerned, the warrant that was issued had not been properly endorsed. As a result of it, there was a technicality that had been missed. But you still said that that technicality is not one that is sufficient for you to quash that FIR. Now, yeah.
The second FIR.
The second FIR. So my question to you is that despite finding a technical illegality, what was the thinking behind the final holding, which is going to be of great assistance to everyone listening, that you still said that the technical illegality should not override the substantive injustice that will be caused?
No, two things. That these people, Rajayya was when a second FIR, no, not a second, actually, there were five cases against him even before the party was dispatched to apprehend him. Four cases, the main allegation is charges 302, one case it was 307. Now, that these facts are undisputed even before the High Court. The fact that such crimes were registered and pending investigation, and one of them, a warrant, was in fact issued by the concerned court. Question is whether it was endorsed or not is a question, or if you required a finding, you didn't find any endorsement. That's a different matter. If a person is required in five cases, of which four are murder cases, that one is an attempted murder. The fact that there is a procedural irregularity in apprehending him, could it result in the issue of writ of habeas corpus, is a question. Now, for two reasons, we declined to grant the relief of the writ of habeas corpus. One is, it would be too late, assuming that it is set aside. The minute he comes out of the court, the police can still arrest him because there are four penal cases, cognizant offenses are there. One thing. Second thing, and more important from the point of view of the system, is what is this law which says that you take all these precautions and take X, Y, Z steps before arresting a man? What is the purpose behind all this? To make sure that the police, the law enforcing agencies, do not act arbitrarily and do not hold somebody in custody without any authorization for indefinite period, and to avoid the possibility of any physical injury or harm to the apprehended person. I suppose that is the reason for all these precautions in the law. That is the reason. That's for right. The constitutional mandate that as soon as possible, not more than 24 hours, and arrested person to produce before it. Magistrate, I suppose there is the philosophy behind all these things. There was no allegation that any such thing happened. If there is a technical listing, maybe there are other ways of rectifying the listing, maybe a compensation, particular damage, there are questions, but they were never argued before the bench. Therefore, we saw no justification for imagining Rajayya. But insofar as other four are concerned, clearly there are no legal, terrible ground for continuing them in this thing. Oh. And just imagine if these people, and if you have read the judgment, after they were produced before the magistrate in Andhra Pradesh, then they were searched, and it is said that from them some explosives were recovered. And all the way they were traveling from Parapanchi to Andhra Pradesh with these people happily carrying on. Rajayya was supposed to be carrying a .32 revolver with him. That's what we are calling the judgment. That's the affidavit filed by the police. And some of them were, one of them was carrying some grenades. Others, the whole thing, I'm not on the merits of the case. I'm not on the merits and the conclusion. The point is, if this procedural code, which is enforced in this country for 150 and odd years, even today, if our law enforcing agencies and I only blame the law enforcing agencies when they were produced, the demand was sought, the magistrate should have asked the basic question, how can you bring these people to Andhra Pradesh? What is the offense they have committed here? And now here you say that they are trying to escape, and then they file an application to amend the FIR saying that unsearched, now we find all these materials with the listing. So therefore, this is the efficiency with which the system. The whole idea of citing this case is not to say that Rajayya has become disturbed and disturbed. That's not true. If this is the efficiency with which we follow the law, this whole doctrine of the rule of law goes through the window.
That's right. I think that's a very valid point. And to those who had some problems in hearing, as Justice Chalameshwar's basic point was that in this case, as in many others, his philosophy has really been that procedure is a handmaiden of justice. Procedure cannot become all pervasive so that it can defeat the ends of justice, which is why Rajaiya, as in was, despite the fact that there was a technical illegality in that arrest, a writ of habeas corpus was not issued and Rajaiya continued to remain incarcerated. And the citations of these, I will send it to you in a moment so that anyone who wants to read further can do so.
And Arjaya, the more interesting fact is, of course, after deciding this case within a year, I left Hyderabad. I went to go with I learned later this man was cleared of all the charges. He contested the next election and became a member of the legislative assembly.
So certainly our tryst of having criminals in politics continues. But whether he was a criminal or not is a different issue, but at least you didn't give him a writ of habeas corpus. Now, so now actually I'm going to jump from there, which is a judgment of yours from the time you were a judge in the Andhra Pradesh High Court, to one of your last reported judgments in the Supreme Court. It was a very interesting triple murder case coming out of Gujarat, because I'll be very frank with you and the listeners. I see Justice Chalameshwar primarily as a constitutional law expert and judge, but he has written some fantastic criminal law judgments. And his last one was a triple murder case from Gujarat in the case of Vinubhai Ranchodas versus state.
Yeah.
And there, as in for our listeners, as in it was a triple murder case and there were several facts, and I'll send the judgments. But the key issue was that it had been 26 years since that incident had taken place. I might be off by a year or two, but somewhere in the region of 26 years.
1989, the incident took place.
Yes.
1992.
2018. So 26 years since the incident took place. And you found that in the trial itself, as in there were sufficient grounds for a retrial to be ordered because the trial had not been carried out in accordance with law. But again, maybe coming back to this procedure.
Sorry to pause there for a minute. I'm sorry to say,
yes.
Nothing went right in that case. Nothing went right in this case. Neither the investigation, nor the trial, nor the appeal. I'm sorry to say, but I have recorded it. I'm not saying it off the top.
That's right.
Part of the judgment.
So, but then the remedy, and this is where it's interesting, because when it comes to the remedy, as in you say in the judgment, and we are discussing this as an academic matter, that as far as the question is concerned, that instead of ordering a retrial, which you said will not serve the ends of justice, given it has been 26 years, some of the persons may not even be alive at this point of time. I think one or two of them had passed away. Some of the witnesses had died, and you instead said.
Also, one more fact, remember, in criminal law and in the appreciation of evidence, you know that principle. Evidence obtained after long lapse of time would have very limited value in law.
That's
so
right.
What is taking evidence again after 26 years?
Yes. So instead you did what is an interesting innovation, which is you ordered, like in Nilavati Behra, public law compensation to be paid in the instant case. Now,
to the victims or their families as a case.
To the victims and their family. Now, do you think that compensation is a way that we can try and, if not solve, but at least mitigate the problems of delays in our judicial system, particularly criminal law?
Well, it requires a bit of debate by all the stakeholders. It could be one way. Then one more thing, by making the amount to be paid from the state exchequer, we may not be okay. You may do some justice to the victims or the families, But then we may not be doing really justice to the system because nobody is the bother. If you can make the wrongdoer or the inefficient officer or the prosecutor, well, of course, if I say inefficient judge, I know a lot of people will follow from that. Then, you have to handle these things.
That's right.
If a session, I have recorded that judgment, if a session judge could frame, write one sentence saying that all you people are accused of offenses X, Y, Z, so on, so on, then charged properly against 17 accused. Oh. Maybe some of them are chargeable only under 149. Maybe somebody else has lesser offenses, because lesser offenses are all indicated. So, who is charged with which offense is not clear from the judgment. If there is the efficiency level of the judicial officer, device must be created to deal with such people.
Well, currently,
through the system.
Unfortunately,
blame policeman or the public prosecutor.
That's right.
So each one of us in the system, investigating agencies, the prosecuting agencies, and the judicial officer, their efficiency levels, they do matter. That's why these things are delayed.
Absolutely. But currently, the unfortunate reality is that, of course, while in some cases compensation is ordered, but the way in which the Supreme Court appears to try and solve the problems of inefficiencies in lower rungs of the judicial hierarchy or in the police is by taking on more matters for itself. Now, I know that you have, I'll just complete this thought. I know that you have several times lamented the fact that the Supreme Court should not become a bail court in the country. The Supreme Court should not continue to hear bail matters. But two facts for your consideration. One, yes, you have already given is the absolute levels of inefficiency that exist in various cases, not only at the lowest level of the judicial hierarchy, but also in the police investigation and prosecution, number one. Number two, and I have just written an article on this today. I don't know whether you've had a chance to see it, but I looked at the judgment of the sessions judge in Delhi in a case relating to the Northeast Delhi riots. It was a bail application moved by a 21-week-old pregnant lady, Safura Zargar. Now, I don't want to get into the merits of the case. It was a bail application, so we don't need to get into the merits of the case. But the basic law, and I'm also not getting into this UAPA question, because there was a question about the UAPA and I can get into that if someone asks a question. But the basic law is that the judge must be satisfied that there is a prima facie case. And to be satisfied that there is a prima facie case, and there must be some evidence that links the action of this lady who had supposedly given a speech and had participated in a WhatsApp group with some incidents, which in this case were some riots. Okay. Now, that entire judgment, while well written, does not contain an evidence of that linkage. It says the lady gave a speech. It says that there were some incidents. Now, without that linkage, it baffles me as to how a prima facie case, particularly for an unlawful or a terrorist act under the UAPA, can be established. Now, given that errors of this nature, and I think it's an error, someone may feel free to disagree, but errors of this nature are made at the lower level of the judiciary. As in, don't you think that A, the Supreme Court is intuitive, as in it's being humane in saying that we want to take on these matters and correct the injustice that is done? Or alternatively, do you think there should be some other solution?
I always believe Supreme Court correct, it can't become a court of error, correcting every error committed by every judicial tribunal or court in this country. Yeah, unless you lay down the law, clear law, and make sure that the system functions effectively. If you are examining the correctness of the judgment of the High Court, irrespective of the fact whether there is a great constitutional question or not, let us say the matter of bail, what is the underlying principle that the Supreme Court perhaps is of the opinion? Perhaps it's of the opinion that maybe the High Court was not right. High Court was not right. If such a belief is prevalent, average every week maybe about 100. I have last count in the last 2 years. What are the numbers? I don't know. An average about 100-150 bail applications come to the Supreme Court from the High Court. And as the Supreme Court is inclined to examine these matters, essentially there is a belief that the High Court's conclusions are required to be re-examined here. Then obviously there is something else to be examined, the recruitment process. What kind of people are being met, I could get without any disrespect to anybody in this matter. Mm. There are much larger philosophical problems in this. See, for 100 years, almost 90 years, this country functioned only with High Court. There was no Supreme Court prior to 1915. It was only the High Courts. High Courts were the final courts. Very few matters went to the Privy Council. Now, I'm not saying that the High Court, the quality of the High Court those days were fantastic and the quality is not good today. I'm not saying all these things. Please don't misunderstand me. Point is, if this kind of scrutiny is to be taken up in every matter, see, for example, Arkea, if you remember, mine was a dissenting judgment in a constitution bench where the question was whether there should be open court hearing in a review petition in a capital punishment matter.
That's right.
Remember.
So I think for the benefit of the listeners, as in Justice Chelameshwar was on a constitution bench where the question had arisen as to whether a review petition in a death penalty matter must be heard in open court. And Justice Chelameshwar had dissented and said that it need not be heard in open court. Please continue, sir.
No. See, of course, there are views and views on the matter. The majority held that that's a law of the country today. I'm bound by it. But then let us examine the problem, apart from the judgment. See, under the text of the Constitution, there is not even a right of appeal in the case of a death penalty. The only right of appeal arises when there is a reversing judgment. The trial court acquits the accused of an offense which is punishable with capital death penalty, and the High Court reverses it and imposes capital punishment, then there is a right of appeal under the text of the Constitution. Otherwise, merely because death penalty is awarded by the trial court and the High Court and the report trial confirmed it, there is no right of appeal. Now, on that, if you see the court today, Supreme Court today, forget about death penalty matters, even in life imprisonment matters, almost every 302 case, appeal, SLP, the leave is granted. The granting of the leave is another story in the Supreme Court today. SLPs or notices ordered, matters are examined. The understanding is, well, they are serious matters, let us have another look at it. We start examining it that way. Apparently, what is it? There is some lingering doubt. Maybe the High Court is not right. So, therefore, then strengthen the High Courts. Improve the quality of the High Courts if you think that the quality is not good. Or if their judgments require further this thing, obviously. Nobody says it. The whole difficulty in this thing is nobody wants to come out clearly what is the problem. And then, fair enough. Then will the Supreme Court be able to handle all these problems? How long will it be able to? Now, every 2 years, the number of the judges of the court increases. I have nothing against it. Very good. Their point is not there. But then, eventually, all the matters will have to be examined by the Supreme Court. And then what will happen to the system?
So your answer
then,
is?
Therefore, in the whole process, all right, then do it with the High Court. Let everything be designed by the Supreme Court or some such thing. At least the time frame would be reduced. This 25 years, 30 years, it must still be consumed in the process. The High Courts are abolished. But then, see, the process problem is one of the efficiency of the system. If you don't improve the efficiency of the system, this enormous time consumption would be there.
That
lead frustration among the people, among the victims, the general public. And then the knee-jerk reactions like what happened in Hyderabad or Warangal. I'm sure these things are known to me. Maybe in other states also such instances must be there. Because India is, whether it's India is one or not in good things, in all bad practices, India is one. These things happen all over. Good things from other states or not.
I think that is an unfortunate reality that bad practices in India are certainly spread very quickly across the country. So I think your solution is an interesting one, that the Supreme Court cannot solve this problem case by case by admitting more 136 matters. And the systemic answer lies in improving the quality of particularly our subordinate judiciary, our police processes, which are more difficult reforms.
The legal education, the kind of people who become lawyers, the kind of arguments that are placed, the public prosecutors, the investigating officers, what is the training we give them? In law, except some physical exercise in the training college? What is the training which is imparted to these investigating officers?
That's right.
No, therefore, they're bound to commit mistakes.
That's right.
Then those mistakes are bound to be highlighted by the defense counsel. The defense counsel happens to be a more seasoned one, he'll be able to do it with greater efficiency. Right. Then the court will have no option.
I understand. So I think we've got a number of reasons to answer that first question that I asked. Is it why do we think the criminal justice apparatus has collapsed? And I think one is clearly the fact that we don't give training to our personnel. Our legal education requires improvement. And ultimately, that delays in the justice system are...
And the audit of any one of the deficiencies of any one of the systems is not there.
That's right. There's no audit. And most importantly, that the delays in the justice system make it frustrating for the common person to come into the justice system. That is why for the last 5 years, I have said that the motto of the Indian judiciary should be Jaldi, justice access and lowering delays in India. That really has to be the motto of the Indian judiciary. So the last question from me, before a point of discussion, before we open it up to, we've got about 142 participants, and it's a good number, the power to do complete justice, 142, the power that you wielded for many years. But coming back to...
You would have to explain Article 142, because students sometimes would not know what is... You said 142 correlates with Supreme Court. So sometimes you would have to explain that 142. In a common flow, one doesn't sometimes realize that some people...
No, thank you, Vikas, for pointing it out. So given that there are many students here, if you read the Constitution, you'll see Article 142. Article 142 provides an extraordinary power to the Supreme Court to do complete justice. My own view is that the Constitution framers didn't think of it as that extraordinary, but the Supreme Court has certainly over the course of the last 70 years made it truly extraordinary. So we can get into a debate on that later as to what the extent of the 142 power should be, but let me end with where I started. We are seeing in America today, pursuant to the George Floyd murder, that there is a nationwide demand for police reform. In fact, the Minneapolis city has said that it is going to disband its police force and going to build it again. Now, the history of police atrocities in India is much older than George Floyd and unfortunately parallels any atrocity that is committed in America. But police reforms in India still seem to be a distant dream. So I'll go back to Hyderabad, where I started, which is that people seem to have lost faith in the criminal justice system. If you had a magic wand, what would you say are the 2 to 3 key reforms that are needed so that people again have some faith in the criminal justice system?
See, the reform which I have always advocated is that the duties of the police must be streamlined. You can't use the same police inspector for crime investigation, EAP bandobast, and natural to managing the natural disasters and things like that. crime investigation is a specialized effort. Now, what is the officers who are to deal with the crime investigation of crime must be specially trained for it. That's one of the reforms I would submit. I'm not giving a complete charter of reforms. That's one thing which is essential.
Okay, so that's about specialization in police force. So I think that's that's actually a good segue, Vikas.
You can't have late Mr. Ramdeep Malanis as the police inspectors, but you must teach them some basics of criminal law.
That's right.
How to frame a charge, how to register a crime, and then what are the steps to be taken before arresting a man and before searching a house or searching a person. These are the basics. And quite often, they are not even aware of it. Forget about their irreverence to law. Quite a large number of them are simply ignorant about it. Now, if a man knows what is the law to be followed and then derelict in his duty, there is a different story of how to deal with that person, a man or woman, is a different matter. So quite often, they don't even know what is the actual legal provision which he is supposed to implement.
That's right. That's
the trouble.
That's right. So I think police training is a key area that you've suggested. Of course, there are many more, but because we have many questions, Vikas, will you take it? How do you want to do it?
Both of us can take it. Like once I am reading, you can take the another question. Sir, this is a question to you by Gomti. What, according to you, should be the ultimate aim in handing over the punishments by way of imprisonment, etc., to the convicts? Should that be predominantly reformative or rehabilitative in nature, or just deterrent in nature towards the others so that the others are stopped from doing that? What do you call on that?
Because it doesn't depend upon my opinion or your opinion. The punishment, when is given, let us say somebody is given a sentence of life imprisonment, whatever is the philosophy behind it makes no difference to that man. What is the effect of that punishment is to be seen. For an average mind, how does it operate? So somebody is an ordinary criminal, not a very educated or very intelligent man. Somebody who has done something out of rashness, of momentary loss of discretion. He does commit an offense and it is sentenced. Would he come out a reformed person or not? It all depends on various factors. What kind of conditions obtain in the jails? And do we undertake any reformatory practices in the prison? It all depends on these things. What you and I think...
No, I get that. So I'll just quickly follow up because there is a interesting question from Gyanesh Bhatt. He gives he's given an example, but it could be an example from anywhere. He says, in a case in UP's Gorakhpur, the crime branch police officer asked for 50,000 rupee bribe to take some accused names out of a case, that too of a student who was wrongly framed, arrested and charge sheeted. What remedy can be there against some arbitrary and malicious arrest? Now, this is a larger question, which is the elephant in the room that we have avoided studiously so far, which is the question of corruption. I know there is no easy answer to this question, but it could be Gyanesh Bhatt in Gorakhpur, or it could be any other any other person in any other part of the country. This is a constant problem that we all face.
Yes.
What is your sense?
No.
Is there a solution?
Some states have, under the local police laws, some states have a police ombudsman. Some of the states. I don't know whether UP has such a provision or not. I'm not very sure. Let them check up. If there is some such thing, might be a complaint to the ombudsman.
This now, clarifies is a real case. This is a real case.
Or somebody, like similar to Lokayukta. Some states have the Lokayukta establishments where the misdemeanor of public servants could be examined. Now, but one thing in the whole process is this, Arya. This allegation of corruption, it's difficult to establish under the law we have. And we know most often it depends on circumstantial evidence. Very rarely, once in a way, you get to nowadays a video clipping. Somebody is intelligent enough to record the conversation. In spite of it, people got away with things. It's a different story. Now, it's very difficult to establish this thing. But the legal way out is only that I can think of. Making the ombudsman if it's available, laptop is available.
Yeah, you're right. This is not a easy problem, Mr. Bhatt, as in this is a difficult issue. But as Justice Chalameshwar points out, and I think it's right, that we have seen that if there could be police ombudsman laws in various states, that could be a measure of police accountability. And ultimately, as in, and I'm not holding a brief for the police here, but it must be said that one of the key problems as in with the police force is the fact that we don't train them. We give them lathis. And we expect that they are not only going to control law and order, they are going to deal with terrorism, they are going to deal with riots, they are going to deal with VIP protection, they are going to deal with a host of range of issues. That doesn't mean to say that it's a license for them to be corrupt. But I think we also have to see how we staff our police force, how much money we are spending on the police force, and what training we are giving it. Because at the end of the day, you get as good a police force as you are willing to pay for. So if you are going to pay for it more and you're going to give them staffing, get good people, then I think as in that is a long-term systemic solution, but there is no real quick fix.
Argo, this question has been posted to you. Since you are reading yourself, you can also do. This is by Debrishi Chakravarti. I can also read that. In your article, you have drawn reference for future, drawn reference from Justice Krishna Iyer saying that bail being the rule and jail being the exception. While I understand, though not entirely, the relevance of it in Jafura's case, but would yielding to that be prudent as a general principle? What is your take on that?
Yes, absolutely. And I think that this is not me, but this is, and not just Justice Krishna here, but this is generations of precedent, not just in India, but everywhere else in the world, that in any civilized criminal justice system, bail must be the rule and jail is the exception. And then there are there's one principled reason for it. The principled conceptual reason for it is that a man is innocent until he is proven guilty. And if a person is an under trial, then that under trial is innocent. And if he's innocent, then he has a right to have his liberty intact. Now, of course, there must be an exception. And the principles for the exception are really well laid out, as both by Justice Krishna Iyer and elsewhere in our bail jurisprudence, that A, there must be, as in, he must not be a habitual offender who can tamper with evidence or tamper with witnesses, must not be a flight risk, someone who will abscond from justice. So I and the judge must be satisfied there is a prima facie case. So I think that as a general matter, as a general principle in India and elsewhere in the world, rightly so, bail is the rule. There is another reason as to why this is so in India, is that we must realize the fact that all our jails, bar none, are overcrowded. And they are primarily overcrowded with under-trial prisoners. This relates to the question that the lady earlier had asked Justice Chalameshwar, which is, what is the purpose of the criminal justice system? Should it be reformative or should it be deterrent? Currently, it seems that if you are putting under-trial prisoners as in jails for lengthy periods of time, then it is neither reformative nor it is deterrent. In fact, it encourages further criminal activity, because you are putting under-trial prisoners together with hardened criminals and convicts. Sometimes you have divisions in jail premises, but sometimes you don't. So there is another practical reason in India as to why bail should be the principle, unless otherwise so, which is that it leads to overcrowding of prisons, and I'm not even getting into COVID-related issues. So I'll stop there.
I'll tell you something. I'll go by my personal experience of my parent high court. In the old state of Andhra Pradesh, all major offenses. During the pendency of the trial, after the charge sheet is filed, bail used to be the norm. Very exceptionally, jail used to be the situation. But once convicted, found guilty by the trial court, an appeal, let us say in 302 cases, an appeal comes to the high court. As a norm, as a convention, the Andhra Pradesh High Court never granted bail, Andhra Pradesh High Court never granted bail for a 302 convict, barring grounds of some such extraordinary situation. As a rule, it was rejected. In fact, very eminent senior counsel refused to move bail applications in a 302 appeal, saying that it's futile, there's no point. The tradition of this court is not to grant. Now, so therefore, bail also at various levels, pending trial is something, pending appeal is something, pending Supreme Court is something. In fact, when I was in the Supreme Court, as a broad thumb rule, I used to follow after I started proceeding in jails. If somebody is in jail for 10 years after conviction and the appeal is pending in the Supreme Court, then we used to consider grant of bail because it served a major portion of his sentence. So, otherwise, what is the point in issuing notice in the SLP? After 5 years or 7 years, you come to a conclusion that the conviction is wrong. What is the purpose would it serve? The man has already spent about 10 years there. Okay, let him go. Subject to, exceptions are always there. Certain precautions have to be taken in some cases, so on and so forth. So these are all things which are required to be examined on a case-to-case basis with by trained legal minds.
Fine.
There can't be thumb rules in these things applicable to all situations. And second thing is, why is it all, see, and I said Andhra Pradesh High Court never used to entertain bail application in the sense, normally not used to do it. By the time I entered the profession in 1976, the duration of pendency for a 302 appeal in the erstwhile Andhra Pradesh High Court is maximum 1 year. Within 1 year, the High Court used to dispose of, claim the entire pendency of the previous year. So, in which case, if the man is not granted bail, okay, in a case where he is eventually acquitted, maybe he would have suffered some problem for a year, not many, but anyway, there is a system which can't help it. But at least the system works with certain degree of efficiency, these things can be adjusted. Now, but if the court doesn't decide the appeal for 15 years, we have seen high courts where matters are pending for 15 years, in fact, I have seen an appeal sitting in the Supreme Court, which came before our bench, where the appeal was pending for 24 years in a particular high court, I don't want to name it. I'm not blaming any individual, but the system is certainly, there's something wrong with it. If an appeal is pending for 24 years in a high court, and if you're not to case, well, I think there's something wrong, and with this kind of thing, what happened in Hyderabad would happen. Okay. In fact, in one of those cases, with not 24 years, a little less, we initiated something is to be done, we issued notices in that case. To the register of the Uttar Pradesh High Court, saying that please do something about it, and then we kept a monitoring mechanism. Of course, I retired, I think this is how we're still monitoring it matter. Some reports were called and so on. And something has to be done about it. You can't keep things pending for 20 years. It is neither just in the context of the accused nor in the context of the victim. Forget about
Yeah.
You must find some way to get things done at an earlier date. You have to devise. The system must devise some way of clearing these areas faster.
Absolutely. Vikas, next question.
Yeah. Advocate Sujit Pathak. Sir, he wants a take. Criminal cases are delayed due to report awaited from forensic labs. Can allowing of private labs come into picture will speed up the criminal justice, or what is your take in that?
It can be tried, provided the private lab's reputation is good. Who is the private lab is the question ultimately. Who is running the private lab? Is the reputation of the lab and is the integrity of the people running the lab unquestionable? If it is then, well, there's nothing. And how do we determine? It's a matter of whether the state will have to evolve some scheme by which maybe some kind of empanelment after checking up their credentials and their background and their efficiency, so on and so, some kind of an empanelment of this private lab. Perhaps it's possible. So nothing can be straight away answered, but it is an idea worth experimenting with. First of all, it is to be discussed. What are the precautions to be taken before entrusting a forensic examination to a private lab? And it needs a debate. Let it be experimented.
So there's one question which I think is an interesting one on the need for sensitization of the criminal justice system. The person, Smriti Rao, is asking
So
my question basically was that do you think that there's an imminent need of sensitization in the entire criminal justice system, and not just the police or the courts? As we've seen, as a resident of Hyderabad myself, the rape case and the killing of the accused was very, it sent shivers down our spine, because the police knew no limits to their powers. And if we read Pratiksha Bakshi, we can see that even the medical profession who examine the victims of sexual assault, they are also very insensitive to the victims. So do you think that there is an immediate need for sensitization of the criminal justice system, and how do you propose to do this? Either, and if both of the panelists could answer this.
You are getting into areas. What do you mean by sensitization?
Sensitization would be a proposition.
Because we care about the import of these words. What do you mean by saying?
We are unmuting her. Yeah, we are unmuting her.
Please give it to her.
Sir, sensitization in a lot of sense, like firstly to identity. Identity politics, there needs to be sensitization of that. Let it be gender, caste, or any of that, because there are a lot of criminal issues which come in, for example, like child abuse cases. There has to be a more sensitive approach towards such cases, because you can't handle them like you do, say, waging war against a nation.
Young lady, sorry, I didn't get your name.
Sir, Smriti.
Smriti P.
Smriti.
Smriti. See, you're talking about that, it's more of a social problem. Maybe our generations are not sensitive enough. Maybe our educational systems and our social setting are not sensitizing. See, to be more gentle in these matters, to be more cautious, to be more human when dealing with a child or a person who is the victim of some sexual offense is something which is a matter of a personal requirement, which doesn't come by a sensitization course of a month or 15 days. It's a long process. It's an aspect of the culture. It is an aspect of the upbringing. It is an aspect of the education which a person goes through. So, okay, a sensitization program doesn't do any harm. Yes, I agree. Okay, but for a sensitization program for 15 days, if it helps to 1 degree, well, no. To that extent, it's good.
Thank you, sir.
Argo, you can take another question from the chat box.
Okay, so I saw there are two questions which are quite important, and I so I'll actually drive it to you. I'll direct it to you. Is about the adversarial justice system that's followed in criminal law in India. A question is asked by Rajiv Das that isn't it time that we move from the adversarial system to an inquisitorial system, and whether and how it can be achieved?
I think, at least in certain areas, we have already moved on to the inquisitorial system. Not in all the criminal cases. In certain categories of criminal cases, we have already moved on to the inquisitorial system. Now, remember the Tada Act?
Yes.
Burden of proof is shifted. What do you mean by inquisitorial system? Maybe there are other dimensions of inquisitorial system. We are already moved in that direction to some extent.
That's right.
Apart from the actual aberrations in the so-called adversarial systems here and there.
That's right. And I think, as in my answer to that, as in Rajiv, would be that it's not so much a question of whether we have an adversarial system or an inquisitorial system, but I think as a society that prides itself on having the rule of law, then we must be clear as that law is not equivalent to criminalization, because we still think, going back to John Austin, you know, law is the command of the sovereign enforceable by sanction. We think that it's only that sanction element, that element of criminalization, which makes us follow the law. And perhaps it's true. To just give you an example, as in I was at Delhi airport, as in, you know, I was during this COVID time going to take a flight, And, you know, everybody was, obviously no one was following any social distancing. Okay, or there were clearly marks that were laid. No one was doing that. Some policeman came with a danda. Then everybody fell in line. Okay, and this is all at the airport I'm talking about. So it's not as if you're talking about thousands of people. So maybe, as Justice Chelameshwar said in answer to the previous question, as in, it's a question of who we are as a society. And if we only respond as in to criminal penalty, then that's not really the rule of law. That's the rule by law. And I think we have a long way to go before we achieve any rule of law. Vikas, any other questions?
I will take Piyush has sent a message privately on the chat itself. This is a question to Justice Chelameshwar. Do you think that illegal detentions must be charged by the state in monetary or other form to the person who has suffered in this regard?
Yeah, it should be. The person is kept in illegal custody, preventive or punitive, whatever it is. And eventually, if it's found to be illegal, the person must be compensated for the damage he suffered. But the pain he underwent and the damage of reputation he suffered, the state must compensate him. See, I'll tell you something. The process can be very painful sometimes. In fact, I have known a particular case, I'll tell you, Mr. Vikas. An old lady who is about 97-year-old, and unfortunately she is no more now. At the age of 95 or 96, a criminal case was registered against her. The people who registered the crime also related to her. What is the problem? A criminal case for defamation. She is supposed to have published some pamphlet making certain allegations against XYZ in the context of they were the trustees of some temple or something like that. She was supposed to have published a pamphlet. She was 96. Whether she published or not, God knows. Maybe she is not there. No trial took place. Now, this temple exists some 300 kilometers from Hyderabad. This old lady lived there. And a criminal case was registered in Hyderabad at the behest of the so-called victims, because they live in Hyderabad. And their cases, these pamphlets were circulated in Hyderabad. The crime was registered here. It was a complaint. Not a police report, it's a private complaint to the magistrate. The magistrate issued process, calling upon the lady to come and appear before the court, to travel 300 kilometers at the age of 96 to answer the charge. Now, whether factually she committed that offense, whether the pamphlet was distributed by her or not, these are all different questions. And sometimes this process can be terribly traumatic. Terribly traumatic, I know it.
That's right.
It was an extreme example which is known to me. Many cases can be.
No, in India, actually, as is often said, the process itself is the punishment. So
that's right.
That is the biggest problem in the country. I think we can take one or two.
Is that a year later, and therefore our problems ended.
That's right. That's right. So we'll take one or two final questions. There's one from Poonam Maheshwari, which I think is an interesting one to
you. I also felt that was an interesting question.
Yeah.
Yes,
yeah.
Argo, you can take that question.
Yeah. So the question was, she says, my question to your lordship is that witness protection.
I said to lordship 2 years back, yeah.
No, I didn't say lordship. She is saying, so I'm only quoting.
Please tell who it is.
Okay, I will rephrase for her. My question.
Argo, but sir, in our system, they say once a lot is always a lot. Because the question is that after the retirement, people are taking you that your word of any expression is an expression that how the society looks forward for that. That is why they say the lordship that leading to the right path of any track.
Without that appellation.
So my question to you is that witness protection has been the biggest problem where we often see witnesses turning hostile in courts. Even though we have laws to protect against for witness protection, we see that the execution of such laws are ineffective. What kind of reform do we need in this area?
There is a law in place. So where is the reform? And implement the law. Simple.
No, but so what is the reform that is needed in order to ensure that this law is implemented?
No. Who is responsible for the implementation? The person who is not implementing it, take him to task by legal process.
So what is that legal process?
Well, initiate disciplinary proceedings against the man in accordance with law.
But this would be against the state. So you are saying that we should take the state to court. So you are saying that we should take the state to court for a mandamus being issued against the state for not implementing not the law relating to witness protection.
In my opinion, even if a pending criminal case, a witness is not being given the necessary protection in accordance with law, please bring it to the notice of the concerned criminal court, saying that look here, under law, I am entitled for this protection and these people are not doing this protection. Let the court take action. Where is the court? Why should you go to the high court for a mandamus every time?
That's right. Fair enough. That's absolutely right. As I think,
running to the Supreme Court. Everything go to the Supreme Court.
Sir Dipti has framed posted a question, but I will frame it another way. She says that media reporting is affecting primarily the criminal justice system. Do you think that there has to be certain check and balance? Sir, Dipti, she's an advocate in Bangalore. She says that judiciary, media reporting does affect a particular case in a particular manner. What is your take on that? Should there be stoppage and only after the case is decided or done? Or what is the way forward?
Well, reporting of facts can't be stopped. Reporting, in the name of reporting of the facts, if opinions are generated, that is a dangerous situation. Well, I think the media must be sensitized to the problem. Somebody is using the expression sensitized. Because any other expression might bring me into trouble with the media. That's it. See, facts are to be reported. There can be a second opinion about it. But then after the fact, if you start formulating opinions and publishing it, it can create a lot of trouble for the accused.
So I have two just quick points to add to that, Vikas, if I may. And that one is that I think that in order to ensure that media and their particular interpretations of judgments and particularly oral observations, because that's, I think, is what's problematic. There are a lot of oral observations are reported as judgment. I think there is a real case for, at least for the Supreme Court, as in to strongly consider, and there is a judgment of the Supreme Court in this regard also, to strongly consider live streaming of proceedings, as in to the subject to feasibility, except for some sensitive cases. That's number one. And number two, I think the court itself, like the UK Supreme Court, should put out a short media summary of its most important judgments. So if it is a judgment like Justice Chelameshwar was a part of in NJAC or a judgment, say, Ayodhya, I think the court itself should put out a very short media summary of its judgment so that the facts become clear and everybody, the discerning reader, will at least be able to understand that everything else is interpretation. So Vikas, shall we close there?
I think because the way Justice Chelameshwar is taking the issues and you are also putting the inputs, the questions will keep on pouring in. But we think that every time we say that a line has to be drawn somewhere, not the Lakshman Rekha, but some Rekha, that otherwise the questions will keep on pouring. But that sometimes gives you an idea that yes, we can look forward where we can take certain issues on this platform once again on a different perspective, different issue. We are in fact all enamored for the fact that Justice Chelameshwar, as you said, it was rightly, and Justice Chelameshwar can agree on that aspect. I also felt that since nowadays, at least during the lockdown, we are all getting invites, but I didn't find that Justice Chelameshwar has actually expressed anywhere, be that the Zoom or any other application. We are enamored for the fact that both of you have given the insights which actually people are latching upon. I can also see on the Facebook that large number of participants, I think it should be one of the record participation today, that we have been able to hear the expressions coming forth from two persons known in their own field. So before I will also ask, since Argo, I will not say that he was one, you were the keynote speaker, but I will take Argo on this side. Once I express thanks on behalf of Beyond Law CLC, I will say Argo would go beyond law CLC and express in general for all the participants the expression of thanks that you actually accepted our invite, gave the input, gave the insights on a different perspective. And we look forward that whatever convenient day and time, if you can come on a different topic, on a different issue, which will be having deep insights. Thank you on behalf of Beyond Law CLC to Justice Samleshwar, Argo Sen Gupta, and the person who got me connected to both of you, to him, I will not name him. Argo knows it very well. Argo, a formal vote of thanks from you because you are moderating also and you are to conclude it also.
Okay, thank you. So I'd just like to say, first of all, thank you to Justice Chelameshwar for accepting this invitation. As I had said right at the beginning, Justice Chelameshwar has not appeared in too many of these lockdown Zoom invites. And so it was very...
Lockdown in the village.
So he was genuinely in lockdown. And for those of you who don't know, Justice Chelameshwar lives in a village in rural Andhra Pradesh.
100 days.
Yeah, 100 days. And so, well, it's
the interesting aspect is just like he said, it is Article 40. Right now, the participants are also 100.
The participants are also 100. So it's, I'm particularly delighted that Justice Chelameshwar could join us on a topic that is of real interest to lawyers, because it's the daily bread and butter of lawyers is the criminal justice system. It is why it exists for the common man. So I'm delighted that Justice Chelameshwar both suggested the topic and gave his frank and candid views. I'm also thankful to all the participants, more than 142, who turned up for this and many more on Facebook. I know you had many questions. We couldn't take all of them, but thank you very much for coming and asking. And on behalf of Justice Chelameshwar and myself, since I find myself as a bridge in this regard, thank you to Vikas and for Beyond Law CLC for organizing this. It was a real pleasure. Thanks very much.
Before we take off, tomorrow, since the issue of mental training, etc., has become relevant because of the circumstances which have happened in the past few days, we are holding a webinar tomorrow on mental training and personality development. And those two, three speakers, though it will be more like an interactive session, but they are persons well known in India and beyond India to the aspect of mental training, which is a relevant point in time that sometimes you don't meet what you actually expire. So tomorrow we have Dr. Harish Chetty, who is a renowned psychiatrist, pan-India and world across. Then we have Dr. Mugdha Dhamankar Bharave. She's a co-founder of Disha Consultancy and founder of Mind Sports. In fact, if we recollect, Shreyas Iyer, when he continuously was hitting back-to-back man of the matches, he owed this entire mindset to Dr. Mugdha. That was the transformation. And then we have Mr. Nilesh Kulkarni, a former cricketer of India, and then he runs an academy of IISM. These all three persons are invariably that how to get themselves out in a given circumstances when you are down. Because we all say that you may be down, but you cannot be out if you have that grit to come across. And Beyond Law CLC was also a concept during the lockdown, only with an intent that we should think within the law, beyond law. That is not beyond law to violate the law, but for the purposes where you can actually think over any issue and how to bring a better society for it. Thank you, everyone. Stay blessed. Stay safe. Not only the participants who participated in the Zoom, as well as on the this. Thank you, everyone. Thank you.